Good morning, everyone, and a warm welcome to the 25th meeting of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2023. We have a first agenda item to begin to take evidence as part of a pre-budget scrutiny on funding for culture. And we're delighted to be joined this morning by Duncan Dornan, Chief Committee Member from Vocal, Pamela Tullock, Chief Executive of Scottish Library and Information Council, SLIC, India Divers, Policy and Campaign Officer for Museums Association, David Avery, Negotiation Officer with Prospect, Cara Christine, Senior Programme Producer for ATLINK, and Liam Sinclair, Co-Chair of the Federation of Scottish Theatre. So it's a roundtable discussion this morning. We want it to be quite free-flowing, so not too formal. So if you do want to come in, please just indicate to myself or the clerks, and we'll try and ensure that everybody gets an opportunity to come in. So I'm going to open with a question on a report from last year, which I think the theme that came out of that was the perfect storm facing the arts culture. And thank you all for your written submissions that have come in, which have been very, very helpful for today. But I would like to open with a question to each of you about what has changed in the operating environment over the last 12 months, what impacts the cost of living crisis, the current financial situation has had on your organisation, and whether that's impacted the services that you've been able to provide. And I wonder if I could start on the left-hand side and we'll go around the table. And Duncan, please.
Yes, a very central question. Obviously, the report last year identified the sector was facing a perfect storm. At that time, we had depressed income on the back of COVID, budget pressures and increasing operating costs. Although the footfall into cultural venues has recovered very well after COVID, the impact of the cost of living crisis has meant that income has not recovered on an equal basis. So though we have more footfall and ironically, therefore, in many cases, more costs, the income is still depressed, even relative to pre-pandemic period. At the same time, the level of funding from local authorities is continuing to be under pressure, and that's having a significant impact across most cultural provision local authorities provide. After 10 years of cuts, we have arrived at a point where the invisible reduction has now gone. Historically, we were able to take back-of-house functions out to reduce investment and maintenance and so on to maintain a level of public provision. We've now arrived at a position where that's no longer possible, and we are beginning to see cuts in programming, cuts in workshops, and cuts in the quality of public provision, which will have a major impact. We know that culture is a very cost-effective way of improving health and well-being and a very effective way of reducing expenditure on primary health care. At the same time, we know that it's very effective both in driving tourism and generating income and driving inward investment. But we are, in fact, seeing a depletion of our ability to do that, which will have major long-term consequences. This sector generally, after more than 10 years of budget pressure, is in a position where it's not only losing public-facing provision, but actually its ability to bounce back and its ability to deliver major high-quality activities. This year, as an example alone, as you may well be aware, that the Burling Glasgow won Art Fair Museum of the Year. It's a major international prize. Simultaneously, the service is removing 38 posts, or 12% of its workforce. So our ability in the longer term to deliver projects of that international status will be very heavily impeded.
Thank you. Cara?
Yeah, I would echo much of what you said there, Duncan. I mean, the conditions continue to be really, really tough. The increased costs and standstill funding is eroding our capacity to be able to address the exponentially growing needs of people with complex disabilities. And then I guess then the double whammy that they are also facing increased cost of living pressures and the reduction of funding to social care means that, I mean, we've even seen staging locally based activities, people with complex needs being unable to actually get to it because they don't have a staff member to bring them. So we're having to respond in a much more local way, a much smarter way, a much more partnership working way. I guess the continued erosion of local government support for the arts is really marked at the moment. And the move to transfer responsibility of cultural assets is also a challenge for local communities to face the maintenance costs of those buildings, so it's not necessarily an opportunity for some of the communities that we operate in, for example, West Lothian. we are trying to challenge the narrative of those difficult decisions and those annual budgets and the unknowns. I mean, we've done that for years, and the art sector is expert at responding to the unknown. We are consequently trying to develop less uncertainty by developing quality work, which involves partnership working, identifying new resources, different ways of thinking, different ways of collaborating. With our public partners and our third sector organisations. So we're trying to move away from a transactional model, much more to a longer term way of thinking and seeing how we can bring in investment and increase not just the cash possibilities of that, but our experience, our knowledge and how skills can be valued. And that's for the people that we work for, as well as the sectors that we operate in. So we're not thinking just about resources in hard cash. We're thinking about creativity and ingenuity of the people that we work with and the way that they see the world and how that can enrich and offer new opportunity. So I suppose we're focusing much on what the Christie Commission said in 2011, which is not an outdated document in the slightest. We are still inspired by that document. We're still looking at ways to reduce demand or higher tariff public spend by working in a much more imaginative and early action way. I think I might just let somebody else take on the next part of this discussion. But yeah, we're looking much more about proactive ways of working.
Thank you. India?
Thank you. Yes, I would say that the museum sector in Scotland is at a crisis point at the moment. We are seeing really difficult situations being faced by museums across the country. There has been a hollowing out of services and continued cuts just keep putting more and more pressure on museums. In 2021, the Museums Association conducted research into local authority investment in museums after a decade of austerity. And what we found was during that decade, local authority investment in museums decreased by 23%. And of course, since 2021, we've seen the cost of living crisis and there's continued pressures with rising costs of maintenance, of energy costs, and because inflation is rising so quickly, a lot of the time, if museums are receiving project funding, by the time the project comes to delivery, those costs have gone up so much that it's actually not deliverable for what's been budgeted. The cost of living is continuing to have a real impact on museums. And in terms of visitor numbers, we are seeing a lot of museums having really strong visitor numbers and a return to pre-pandemic levels. But we are also seeing some that are still struggling to return to the same numbers. And a lot of the time, it might be the museums that charge for entry, some of the independent museums, that are experiencing not the same return. And that's because of the cost of living. People are more likely to go to the museums that are free entry. And what we're seeing as well is that visitors, if a museum is charging for entry, they're perhaps only coming if there's an extra bit that's offered, so an extra event or activity that's running, so they can get more for their money. So that is having an impact on museums' income. The museums that are free entry, we're seeing a lot of pressure now that they're now thinking about going towards more commercial models, considering maybe having to charge for entry. And this does cause some concerns, especially in the cost of living crisis, when we saw last winter many museums opening up as warm and welcoming spaces and being a really essential part of the community to offer that service. And there is a real risk if museums are moving towards a charge model for entry that we need to look at who's then going to be excluded and who we're leaving behind if that is the path that we're going down. So I think there's real risks there.
Thank you. David?
To echo what my colleagues have said, that while there is a recovery in visitor numbers, it is uneven. And we're seeing across various different institutions and companies and so on that some are recovering, others aren't. But as has been noted by others, that does not necessarily mean income has recovered. In terms of budgets, we are seeing more of the same. We're seeing flat budgets and increased staff pressures, which are then increased, leading into difficult conversations about staffing, about staffing levels and about pay. I note from, I think it was the National Museum, have said that they haven't had as yet the money for the April 23 pay round released. That continues to be the case now in September, and we're having further discussions with the government about that today. We are continuing to have real issues around pay negotiations within these areas because of the level of budget which has been assigned to them. For the last 3 years, I believe, we've had to have an intervention from government to bail out the museum, the library and the galleries to allow them to pay a pay award broadly in line with what has been paid to other members within the public sector. That is looking like it's likely to happen, it needs to happen again this year, because it's not simply not possible to make savings within their budgets in a way that an organisation such as the Scottish Government is able to do so. Because of that frozen funding, because of those pressures that others have talked about, and unless they moved to something like closing properties or starting to charge more, they are unable to make those kind of savings. In terms of the cost of living and impact on services, we're seeing a higher turnover of staff, particularly in those visitor-facing roles, where organisations are competing not just within the sector, but against private sector organisations who will employ often on significantly higher salaries. And this is having a real impact. We saw the closure of Mod 2 last year, where in part, though not entirely, because of staffing levels. We're also seeing higher turnover in specialist roles as well, where curator and conservation staff are leaving the sector because of pay and because of insecurity of employment, because of insecurity of funding. And we have members coming to us saying, this is what I want to do, this is what I've wanted to dedicate my life to, but I simply can't afford to stay within the sector anymore. And that has become more and more acute over the last 2-3 years with the cost of living crisis and the challenges that it's presenting to people about the cost of staying in Edinburgh. So I think we're seeing, unfortunately, more of the same, more of that storm continuing to hit these bodies. And while some, those centrally funded by government, are in a slightly better position in that they can come to government for further funds, our members working in charities and smaller museums are absolutely the whim of Creative Scotland and often are only finding out what their funding is almost at the 11th hour, which, if it means changes to staffing levels, has a huge impact on those individuals.
I think we'll take the first question and then I'll bring you in for the supplementary, Donald. If we could invite Pam now, thanks.
I'm not sure if I've done some... Thanks. I think the perfect storm is actually a perfect way to describe the situation that libraries find themselves in at the moment. In the SLIC submission, we mentioned that actually it's not the last 12 months that have been challenging, it's been the accumulation of probably about the last 12, 15 years, really, since the credit crunch and public sector austerity. And as you all know, public libraries are funded either directly or indirectly through local government. In your papers for today's meeting, you'll see that a 36% decline in investment in libraries has been highlighted, has taken place over the last 10 years. And perhaps to make that real for people and what that means, we've heard about hollowing out of services, trying to manage on flatter declining budgets. But what we've seen is a reduction in opening hours, closures of libraries in some places, reductions in staffing levels, a real hollowing out of support staff, which actually are needed to make the frontline staff, or enable the frontline staff to carry out their duties effectively. And we've also seen quite a decline in investment in the kind of bread and butter of the library offer, i.e. the book fund. So over the last 5 years, there's actually been a 26% decline in investment in that offer to the public. And perhaps to make that real to people, that's over £2 million every year a £2 million reduction every year in materials that have been spent for the public to borrow across Scotland. And of course that has a direct impact on what children can borrow from libraries, and of course that supports attainment and literacy, which is extremely important for life opportunities and I suppose chances in life. Digital inclusion, which we know is another big issue. We're seeing that digital divide actually grow rather than contract, which is really disappointing despite the best efforts of Stat Library staff on the ground to support the public with their needs there. We've heard talk just now of health and wellbeing and the role that culture and also the role that libraries play in supporting health and wellbeing. And that has never been more important and never been more needed, I think, than now. And yet, it's it's a time that the library sector can't respond perhaps in the best way it would like to. And we've heard as well about collaborative working. There is a collective force for health and wellbeing, which supports the Chief Medical Officer's realistic medicine agenda. And that sees SLIC, the NHS, the Alliance and Digital Health Scotland coming together to actually deliver services in local libraries which help people such as NHS Near Me, working with Diabetes UK and also working with Alzheimer's Scotland, supporting people who are suffering from dementia and so on. But that can only be, it can only happen one if the libraries are there, if they've got reasonable opening hours and they've got staff that can actually help support all of that. There's also evidence come forward that for every £1 spent in public libraries, it brings £6.75 worth of benefit to the community. And that's great. But equally, you can turn that on its head. For every £1 taken away from public libraries, that's £6.75 of benefit that's taken away from the community. So it's a tricky situation we find ourselves in. I think the sector has been extremely resilient and creative in responding, but the kind of trajectory it's on at the moment can't continue if we're wanting to offer what Scotland's had a proud history of, which is a very strong and vibrant public library offer.
Thank you. And finally, Liam, not least.
Thank you. So the Federation of Scottish Theatres members are quite a diverse body. It's maybe worth pointing that out, first of all, that we've got people that are operating theatres and presenting professional production and touring professional production, but we've also got members that work right across a range of community education and social contexts, including, picking up the point there, working in direct therapeutic interventions and to address a whole range of policy areas. All of our members are reporting, to answer your question, it's got worse. The impacts across services, the reduction of choice that's having to be offered is all there. And I think there's a kind of material thing from probably the last time the committee took evidence ahead of the budget, which was the journey that the Scottish Government took with the culture budget through Parliament last year. It would be difficult to underestimate the erosion of faith and trust that that journey had on our members, where the culture budget was cut, albeit to be reinstated. And it left people feeling less clear than they should, I think, about the clarity of vision that we're all operating to in terms of the delivery of cultural services for Scotland. That has a corresponding impact in terms of the health and wellbeing of the workforce, because to again pick up points from colleagues, people are making significant choices now about whether this is a sector they want to work in. And these are a talented and experienced workforce that Scotland's been proud of for a long, long time. However, there is a great amount of determination in the sector. The Edinburgh Festival Fringe is one example, has just had members present a whole range of different work with, once again, international promoters from right across the world saying that the quality of work that Scotland produces is truly world class. So we sort of stand ready to make a contribution, but I think we are at a tipping point now. And I think the passage of the next budget through Parliament, and indeed subsequent budgets, will be a tipping point. And as with tipping points, there's an opportunity to build forward. And with reference to what that looks like, I would draw the committee's attention to the Culture Count submission. Our colleagues there, I think, have done a great amount of work of putting a number to that tipping point change for the better. But if it's at standstill or indeed, worst case, a cut, we will see a tipping point of regression, and that will impact the culture sectors and our members' ability to deliver for the next decade or more.
Okay. I'm going to bring Donald in his supplementary. I see Neil has one as well. I've got one or two. So if other members want to come in on the opening statements, that would be great. So, Donald.
Thank you, Claire. I was very struck by the kind of starkness, I suppose, of what many of you have said, both today and in your submissions. And, you know, Liam just now from the Federation of Scottish Theatre described the tipping point. I think in your submission, yours is there is no space closer to the edge to move to. I suppose my question to all of you is what does this mean in practical terms if we are at a tipping point or a breaking point? Pamela's touched on potential closures, staff reductions, etc. But in terms of the sort of practicalities, I suppose, I'm keen to sort of understand what that means day-to-day operationally. And Liam, perhaps I could start with you.
I think what it would mean is a retraction of services right across what members do. So that would be less productions of that world-class nature being presented. So the export, the cultural export agenda for government would absolutely be impacted. At the therapeutic end, there would be choices made about prioritisation of service that has a greater chance of revenue generation. So you've got a kind of commercial agenda outweighing the sort of social impact agenda, and absolutely our members don't see it that way. They see the kind of revenue generation as a necessity, but absolutely to deliver social purpose for cultural. You would have, I think, a level of quite mass redundancy in the sector. So we've touched through a number of comments of people choosing to leave the sector. We've not quite yet hit a point of mass redundancy. There have been some kind of notable cases in the last year that members will be aware of, but there would be no choice but to maintain the kind of integrity of organisations that have to have a kind of healthy balance sheet in order to trade, to think about what that means for workforce. Nobody wants to go there, because I think we are a sector that take great pride in the skill, the talent, the sort of ambition of the sector, and that is built on a really brilliant workforce. But the sector, yeah, there is no more room to move. We are on the edge. So I think it is a choice point, not to labour the point, but we are in that choice moment of what do we want our culture sector to look like for the next decade.
I don't know if anyone else wants to. Duncan, yeah.
Yep, thank you. Yes.
Just automatic.
So the Liam has mentioned that there are job losses. Those job losses are symptomatic of the fact that institutions have nowhere else to go. And the two last things are job losses and closure of venues. We're seeing job losses. That will have is having an impact on the level of programming, the level of content, the quality of content. It has an impact in the longer term on Scotland's ability to deliver world-class content. But the next step from those job losses is the closure of venues. And I think your description is that we are absolutely on the edge. We are seeing job losses. It's a symptom of having nowhere left to go. It will have an impact on provision. And I think particularly in the public sector, provision for the most disadvantaged and excluded in society. Our latest data shows that of our Scottish audience, 50% are coming from quintile 1 and 2 of SIMD. So the poorest people use our cultural provision. If that's reduced, those are the people who are going to be hit most directly by it.
No.
To add just how that would kind of play out, if you like, if libraries are put under further pressure. Libraries remain the most popular service which local government provides, and we're seeing footfall returning to pre-pandemic levels. And to make that real again for people, that's probably more people using their local public library than attend Scottish Premier League football matches. So, you know, we're talking about a really strong engagement. So we know that libraries at the moment support social isolation and help those that are socially isolated, that they have a positive impact in attainment, that they play well to support digital exclusion. They've really had a strong offer to support families and people through the cost of living crisis. They support people into work and help people remain in work through skills development. And they also reduce issues around mental health and wellbeing. So those are the kinds of societal impacts that you could expect to see exacerbated if the library offer was reduced.
A quick question, with all you've said, specifically, did you see the library's been used as a warm space, like the museums have mentioned
yes,
earlier?
Yes, certainly. Public libraries have been a very strong anchor in offering families support during the cost of living crisis. So certainly warm spaces, but also providing activities. You know, we don't want libraries to be pity places for people to keep warm. So there's been a really strong offer around programming to support people through the cost of living crisis as well. And, you know, that is good for mental health and wellbeing too.
Entia and then David, please.
Add to what others have said and echo a lot of what's been said already in terms of the risks of job losses, of closures. A lot of the time the first jobs to go are kind of learning and engagement, audience facing roles, and those a reduction in those roles is going to have a direct impact on our communities and audiences and those that are the most vulnerable in society. It also poses a risk to collections of buildings if the maintenance costs aren't there, if there's leaks, if there's, you know, not appropriate buildings to store our collections in, then that is a real risk as well. In terms of salaries as well, we are going to keep seeing people leaving the sector. It's already been mentioned front of house roles leaving, and that's something we're seeing that a lot of museums can't keep up with the kind of competitive wages that you might get in accompanying kind of public facing sectors such as supermarkets and things like that. So and we're also seeing that in terms of IT roles and HR roles, that the competitive salaries in different sectors that can offer means that we are going to find positions like this harder and harder to fill. And I also just wanted to highlight kind of the picture across the UK, because, of course, the Museums Association, we are a UK-wide membership body. So we are seeing in England some councils clearing themselves bankrupt, and then the impact on that is anything that isn't a statutory service, which includes museums, of course. There's just no money left for these services, and that's quite a bleak picture if that's the road that we're going to continue on. We also saw in Cardiff a closure of the museum there to turn into a mobile attraction. So there was that this was proposed, and luckily there has been a U-turn on this due to campaigning, but we can see the kind of picture that's forming across the UK and the kind of path that we're going down, and if action isn't taken to stop this, that's where we're going to end up.
Okay, thank you. David?
Yes, and to ask you, I was going to make a similar point to India about the facilities and so on. We've seen a number of submissions, both from ourselves and from other respondents, that pretty much everyone is now facing a choice between staffing levels, opening hours, property closures, other divestments, and that there is very little elsewhere, very little choice now for them. They would have to choose one of those things. And, you know, I'm proud of, within the public bodies, within some of the larger charities, that we have slightly higher rates of pay for heritage staff than we in Scotland than we do in the rest of the UK. But that, unfortunately, just speaks to how bad it is in the rest of the UK, rather than there being a good position here. I would also say that we are losing and would continue to lose work around collection care, around collection cataloguing, around some of that less visible work. You still have, you know, the National Collection still have millions of uncatalogued items that they think they have but are not sure, and we've seen the problems that has caused for the British Museum. That work is under pressure, work around digitisation, work around conservation. As the National Library talked about having to delay work on critical infrastructure, which, you know, if they have a failure of a temperature control system, has a huge impact. And some of this is stuff which you can choose not to replace it, but if it then fails, your costs to replace it are far higher or you risk losing, you know, irreplaceable parts of the collection. These are things that our members absolutely care about, are absolutely concerned about, coming to us saying, I am really worried about what this might mean for the collection. And that is within, as I say, centrally funded museums. When I speak to members who work for charities and so on, it is even more acute.
Thank you. India, you mentioned the speed of the cost of living crisis and inflation meant that, you know, funded projects were now no longer viable. Does that mean they're being cancelled or scaled down or a bit of both?
I think it's a really live issue. So I think it's ongoing. So it's that museums are finding themselves at the moment in situations where they've applied for funding and now they're going to have to try and find the money to deliver these projects. Although they said that this is the budget, this is what we can deliver, now the costs have gone up. So it might be that they're having to scale back slightly, or it might be that they're having to dip into their own money to try and deliver the projects.
Okay. Thank you. So I'm going to invite Ms. Forbes to ask some questions. Thanks.
Thank you all very much. And I suppose to Liam's point, over the summer, I certainly got the privilege of seeing just the quality of the creative and the culture industry, particularly across the Highlands. And I wanted to focus a little bit deeper into three questions, which picks up on Cara's point about preventative spend and acknowledging and quantifying the wider outcomes that culture spend can deliver. Because I think all of us have continued to be inspired by Christie. It's been notoriously difficult to do because in any fixed budget it requires funding to go up in one way and down in another way. So my questions are, firstly, when it comes to the public discussion about funding and funding the culture and creative industry, to what extent do you think there has been progress in actually acknowledging that culture contributes more generally to outcomes? And when I say acknowledgement, I don't mean politicians saying, we accept that. I mean in terms of concrete movement of funding. That might be a short answer. And secondly, when it comes to more general outcomes, Duncan talked about, of course, the impact on health and well-being, impact on education, impact on economy, a tool for reversing depopulation, as we've seen, for example, in the Western Isles with spending on MG Alapa. So what further work would you like to see to demonstrate, to quantify the wider impact of culture spend that can be used as proof, for want of a better word? And then my third and final question, and I'm just throwing them all out there because I thought then you might be able to pick up on each on different elements. In terms of partnership working with the private and the public sector, in terms of, for example, joint projects with the NHS, joint projects with organisations which are tasked with delivering economic outcomes and so on. To what extent have you seen growth in that partnership working so that some of the risk around projects might be shared and it's not just the museums, for example, that are having to fork out, but other organisations can partner?
There's a lot in there. I'm looking. Cara, would you like to come in?
Sure. I'm probably best placed to answer the third point you were making there. So I hope you don't mind me just illustrating your point with some life examples, if you don't mind, and do rein me in, Claire, if you need to. So we've been developing not only our services to support adults and young people with neurodiversity, complex needs, mental ill health, but we also innovate at the same time. So what we're finding is that if you can focus on the individual, really complicated solutions to individual and collective social problems become apparent. And then if you act at a local level, you can then scale up approaches. So I'll just give you a couple of examples. So we work with adults with profound and multiple learning disability and complex needs in our day centre in Bonnyrigg. And through some innovative resource transfer from a care assistant salary, part of a care assistant salary, the manager has bought us in to provide creative learning for their staff team. So if people with profound and multiple learning disabilities have got unique views on the world, how they sense the environment, how they see skill development, what's the ambition for people to continue to learn despite having cognitive disability. Can we change what the centre looks like? Can we programme imaginatively what happens there? Can we use artists across disciplines to try and refresh and imagine what that would be? So for a very small amount of money, you have a year-long programme where staff are engaging in sound, light, vibration, movement as communication, product design, and we've turned a team of action group workers into product engineers so that are redesigning very simple objects to engage the people that they support on a deeper level. The University of Dundee identified the value and articulated, and I think this is really important, is that it's very difficult sometimes for us as a sector to articulate the value, social value, financial value of what it is that we bring to health and social care, education, community. University of Dundee evaluated the role of our work within on a relational level, directly improving the quality of care within health and social care in learning disability. The interdisciplinary collaborations that we can explore through working with OTs, with healthcare, with social care, with education, save so much money in terms of stopping referrals. So one of the projects that I run is a children's project in East and Mid Lothian. I'm working with kids who've been out of school through emotionally based school avoidance for over 3 years, and nobody knows how to fix that, and nobody has got simple answers to that, but the answers come from just listening to what the individual needs. And I'm the kind of fairy godmother of the education world, where I'll go in and I'll find out what a young person is interested in. Now, that could be ferret care, astronomy, graphic design. We match that young person with a practitioner, an expert from the arts and non-arts field, and we make something concrete happen that lifts attainment. So we can then combine whole systems approach money, lack attainment funding, we can use community mental health framework funding and pool those resources to almost innovate a new service. So if we don't have the innovation funding, what we're needing is longer term strategic investment in a coherent way so that local authorities can be given the permission to bring in new services that solve those really complex problems.
Just a small supplementary. In terms of the work you're doing in education, do you ever know where the funding's coming from? That is PEF funding?
It would be PEF. I guess the other thing is that there's a double whammy, as I mentioned earlier, is that if we will use SDS funding within adult learning disability terrain as well, mental health terrain too, but because the eligibility criteria for SDS funding has changed, is that families no longer have maybe as much funding, or they're not having funding at all. So therefore they can only buy in what exists. Now, we can't innovate. I suppose it's becoming a transactional model, isn't it? It's like purchasing services, purchasing support. If we can't innovate from what's there, they can only choose from what exists. And the further that is reduced by a reduction of arts funding. So what we're needing is multi-year funding. We've been moved from regular funded organisation to an open project funded organisation, which means that we have to fundraise for our own salaries at the same time as delivering and innovating the sector. That's a really hard job to do. So yeah, that allowing us to do what we do best, to reduce costs, ongoing costs, to reduce ongoing CAMHS waiting lists because somebody doesn't need that assessment so much is I think where we should be at.
Okay. And Duncan, you wanted to...
Thank you. Yes, I mean, I think that the question about funding culture and the impact on wellbeing is really quite central here, and there is a widespread political acceptance that is a fact, and we have enormous academic information to back that up. And within the sector, we accept that. And actually, I think the public do too. I think there's a widespread acknowledgement that cultural engagement is a good thing, and our audience demographics in Glasgow's museums, I think, reflect that. It's what the poorest in society do in leisure time. But the funding models we have don't support that acts being delivered at scale to have a sufficient impact. The sector currently is essentially an annual cycle of managing decline, and that soaks up enormous amounts of capacity. We simultaneously implement last year's cuts and begin to plan to deal with next year's cuts, and that leaves no scope to actually look at funding models and create in the longer term new sustainable models which actually respond constructively to the society we're operating in. And I think that's one of the difficulties. If we were able to achieve a period of stability to allow us to reimagine our services, we would be able to achieve more and to meet public aspiration. But currently, we're all individually fighting for survival, and we can't do that.
Okay, I'm looking for... Liam?
Yeah, I'd echo both what Cara and Duncan have said already. I think the thing that we know, there's a lot of good example of work out there, and we know that work works, but it's on a quite an ad hoc reactive basis at the moment, and that's all the more strained because of all the things we've talked about in the first round of questions. And so I suppose there's an opportunity, I'm going to stick with this tipping point theme if that's okay, but with the refresh of the culture strategy to move from a reactive to a strategic position on this. And I think there's a couple of things that could be really quite transformative in there. One would be to agree a commitment to ring fencing that portfolio money that's been talked about for quite some time across government. Cara talked about a design process there. And if you're designing product or service, you commit to a prototyping phase. So let's commit to some mass prototyping of interventions across portfolio that build on the extraordinary work that's already going on there, ring fence some money from that. But together, I think that needs to look at what the agreed metrics will be, because I think there is a lot of understanding at quite an implicit level that this contribution to health and wellbeing and education outcomes is there. But we're all working to slightly different evaluation metrics. If we could work to a unified set of metrics while prototyping inside a refreshed culture strategy towards the government's goal of transforming to health and wellbeing economy, that could be truly transformative over the next decade. And in 10 years' time, I'd love to imagine some people sitting around this table going, wow, look at the evidence base of how we've transformed Scotland through cultural intervention across every area of government portfolio.
Pamela?
I would like to again echo what everybody else says, but again coming at it from a library's perspective and having a real hard think, I suppose, about that acknowledgement that you were asking for and the progress that's been made and what would be proof of that. And focusing on a collective force for health and wellbeing, which is the collaborative approach within the library environment, I think one of the real strengths of that is that all the partners were at the table together at the beginning. They had a common goal, and I think that really punches above its weight. So it wasn't, in some scenarios, libraries or the culture sector invited later on in the stage and expected to contribute and do something, but I actually think being at the table right at the start and being able to outline what the culture offer is can be very impactful. And I think libraries do have a real strong evidence base of doing that with a range of partners. And I think part of the USP of libraries, in line with probably museums as well, is that they're trusted safe spaces and that the staff have the skills to work with a range of organisations to bring things to life. And, you know, if I reflect on last year, we had a national reading moment called Keep the Hidden Read, which had a focus on mental health and wellbeing. And it had a range of third sector organisations promoting it. It had a range of private industry promoting it as well as the library sector. But everybody was there at the planning stage. Everyone was there at the start and they all had a common goal. Similarly, with the NHS Near Me, that wasn't about NHS approaching libraries and asking, can you help us with Near Me? It was a true collaboration that came through from a collective force for health and wellbeing. So again, the discussion, the development of the project, the rollout of it involved all partners. And I think that kind of model starts to move away from who's bringing what to the table, but actually how do we collectively bring things together to achieve an outcome.
Thank you. India, you want to?
Thank you. Yes, so there is a recognition of the role of museums in contributing towards health and wellbeing in Scotland's Museums and Galleries strategy, and we were really pleased to see that. And at the Museums Association, our Museums Change Lives campaign really recognises the role of museums in contributing to health and wellbeing as well, and we really encourage this work in the museum sector. However, I do think there needs to be more work done to formalise this work and move away from it being, like Liam said, ad hoc, and to really join up the work that is taking place. There is partnership working happening, particularly when it comes to social prescribing and museums doing work in that area. But I think there is a risk in the way that museum funding comes into a lot of organisations is that a lot of the time it's project-based, it's short-term roles that are working on this, and effective partnership working, it takes a lot of time and effort, and these relationships have to be built over a long period of time and handled very sensitively. And there is a real risk when the people delivering this work are on short-term contracts, that when they leave, this work stops, the relationships are lost, and the people who've been involved in this work are left quite vulnerable because the work has just suddenly stopped. So I think we need to look at how we're funding this work, and it really does need to be permanent staff working on this. It needs to be part of the core of what our museums deliver and cultural organisations deliver. And I think we are at risk of damaging relationships if we don't kind of formalise this work and provide adequate funding towards it as well.
Okay, David.
Just to supplement on the point India's made, it is this project work and this insecure employment that we're seeing particularly a turnover in professional roles in. So you're employed on a fixed-term project or something because the funding is insecure, even if it is something like... So something, as you described, where you're working with more vulnerable groups trying to deliver something, and the staff in it have no idea what happens to them at the end of the end of that contract period. They are the ones who are leaving. You know, that is the group to which we are seeing the biggest turnover in amongst staff who just do not know where the next job is. It doesn't have to be like this. You know, there are plenty of other areas where we work with where project work is normal, but it is undertaken by permanent staff. And there is a period, there is an understanding that there will be more projects and that you'll keep these people on, you retain those skills, and you're able to give them security of employment. And I think this is actually one of our biggest areas of concern at the moment, that we are seeing almost a two-tier workforce, a permanent workforce, who have security, have fair work, have the things that the Scottish Government talks about, but then a second group who are on fixed-term contracts who don't have any security, who don't have certainty about whether what will happen if their funding runs out, or and are often leaving before it does. You know, often the most crucial phase of a project, the last 6 months, they are looking for a job somewhere else because they just don't know what will happen next.
Kate, did you want to come back in? Or
just really briefly, I think that's all been extremely useful. I suppose the point perhaps that we could return to, maybe not in this session but in future, is I think the point that Liam made, which is if we accept that there are significant outcomes when there's joint working, how do you formalise on a macro basis that joint working? So, you know, the only way it worked between health and social care is when joint boards had to share budget. That's formalising it on a macro level, on a universal level. And that's, I suppose, where we want to unpack that further. How do you get to a point where you're sharing budgets in order to embed preventative spend?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I believe that it's on the government's radar to look at metrics and measuring and trying to get some standardisation, because we're also hearing from our previous work the amount of time and effort it takes to actually, you know, prove any outcome and any kind of metrics or toolkits or whatever to do that, I think would be very helpful. Mr. Bibby, yeah.
Thanks, Convener. And thanks for the evidence so far. I definitely agree with Mr. Cameron about the bleak picture that's been painted about the impact of budget pressures on the sector. Mr. Sinclair said earlier that pointed to the Culture Counts evidence that was submitted around a specific figure that was required, 30% increase in the portfolio budget that was required. Obviously, we've heard about the impact that the current budget cuts have been having. I just wanted to ask the rest of the panel, is that a figure that others would support, what Culture Accounts have said? If not, is there a specific figure that you're looking for in terms of the budget? I don't know if David's got any thoughts.
I genuinely don't know what the specific figure would be. I know a figure we need for this year's pay round, but that doesn't necessarily reflect the need for wider increases in the budget and to address some of the areas which have been cut over the last 10 years. What we absolutely need for those centrally funded organisations is for their funding to be at a realistic level where they can achieve the goals that we want to achieve around fair work, around sustainability, around the wage, and to allow them to compete on salary in a way that others can, and that is not what we've seen in the last 4 years, and has then ultimately that meant that the budgets have had to be revised to fill the gaps, which takes time. You know, we were in this cycle, I talked in our written submission, we're in a cycle last year where we eventually got that intervention and a rush to make sure staff got paid before Christmas. I am not at a point right now where I know whether or not anyone who is working in the museums, the library, the National Museum, National Library, National Gallery, will get their April 23 pay rise before Christmas this year. I suspect it's quite unlikely now, because pay negotiations have not even started and that budget intervention is needed. So it is, rather than just saying to those organisations, it is a flat budget, try and make savings, when they have repeatedly been unable to do so, it is actually acknowledging that they are not in the same place as some other public bodies and say, OK, fine, we do need to look at this. Alternatively, we need to give you more options around how you can raise funding elsewhere. We talked in our submission about the museum freedoms that have been granted some of the museums in England. We are not overly positive about some of them, I have to say, but being able to look at multi-year budgets, look at multi-year fundraising, being able to retain your reserves in a way that they're not able to do right now, is a huge challenge for these institutions. And so certainly we would support changes around some of their finance rules to give them more freedom to do that kind of work. It is not without challenges. You know, if there is not an increase in central funding, as I referred to previously, where does the money come from? And is it reduction in service? Is it reduction in opening hours? Is it charging more? Is it looking to sponsorship, which brings its own problems, as the book festival has found this year? So I wouldn't put a number on it, but I think it is a choice that government has to make, that if, and I don't think 30% is an unreasonable figure, if it is not coming from that, if that is not coming from central government, they're going to need to find it from somewhere else or cut services to the same level.
Does anyone else want to comment on values, Duncan? Yes.
I think it is difficult to put a figure on an increase that would be necessary, and that figure is somewhere around 30%. It represents the level of cut we've had, but I think the key thing is that the services we delivered 10 years ago are now dramatically different, and I think also public expectation of services and how we might deliver is quite different. So it's hard to estimate in the basis of what's happened over the last 10 years what we would need. I think what we need is a period of stability to allow us to design services that are genuinely for the 21st century and are genuinely effective. And in the current model, we don't have that. Mm-hmm.
So we've just published a culture report which talked about what was described as donut funding. I think this comes to the nub of project funding and the core staff. And I think you mentioned as well, you know, you're fundraising for your own staff. So would you like to see a more realistic funding model that reflected the support costs for projects rather than just, you know, the sort of project and outcome? I'm seeing nods around the head. That's not good for the official report. Does anyone want to to comment? I'll go to leave and then Duncan, thanks.
I mean, absolutely, yeah. Nodding dog, yeah, absolutely. I think there's a couple of points just to pick up there. One is around that if you provide a good value level of stability at the heart of all of this, you get better outcomes, you get more systemic change, you get all those kind of health and wellbeing stuff that we discussed off Kate's round of questions. We can apply more focus to that transformation agenda if they're stable. I'm not going to go into the specifics of I suppose, culture accounts, because I think Laurie's coming next week, so I'll let her talk to that. But safe to say, it was done with a lot of research, and it still represents extraordinarily good value for the public purse in terms of that intervention. So if you can get the intervention of an amount of money plus multi-year stability that allows the base to be consolidated and stable, you can then have much more of that energy and skill and talent focused on the transformation agenda for a world and a context that is changing fast, and everyone accepts that.
Duncan.
I think your question is really central. So that Scotland has an amazing track record of delivering large-scale capital projects, and the Scottish National Gallery is opening the Scottish Galleries this month, for example. And there is a recognition of the need for staff to support these. But the long-term impact of this funding pressure means that is dissipated. So a project can start using successfully. It will be staffed for a period of time, but eventually it succumbs to the general pressure on funding and becomes part of that revenue challenge. And so I think we're not sustaining some of the great things we're achieving through that capital investment. That donut model is a really good way of describing it.
Thank you. David Jett?
I think the challenge with any assigned or hypothesised funding, and this isn't just a criticism of government, this is also something you get with charitable donations, if it is funding which must be used on X purpose, it can't be used to build the foundations which that project is standing on. So it doesn't pay for the building, it doesn't pay for the IT, it doesn't pay for the infrastructure, which pays the staff. And the inability to then, you know, that foundation has been eroded over time because of cuts to the rest of the budget. It is harder and harder to deliver those things or move that money around. And so, you know, as I say, it is a challenge for charitable organisations where they're given a donation which must be used for something, you know, sometimes more than 100 years ago. And that doesn't translate into a modern context now. But we're also seeing it with funding from government, where you want to use it for this and to support it, and that's just something you're not able to do.
Pamela, you wanted to...
Yeah, I suppose just reflecting on what everyone's been saying and you know, echoing that, but if we're looking for some kind of quick fixes or something to alleviate the kind of immediate pressures that the sector finds itself in, I suppose, you know, it is about looking for that stability that Duncan mentioned and really not asking for efficiency savings at this point in time, you know, to really let the sector just find its feet and hopefully, yes, if there was an extra 30% funding, that would be fantastic, but actually start to move forward, because I certainly feel as far as libraries are concerned, we can't go on finding efficiencies without seriously disrupting the business model.
Do you want to come back in? Are you...
I think another kind of question I had was around... we've heard about what we could potentially do if there was extra funding, and particularly focused on health and wellbeing. I was struck about you know, some of the evidence that was given by Pamela earlier about the impact on library cuts on children and young people. And I've got a real concern that, you know, irrespective of what we'd like to do in the future in terms of, you know, building up the culture sector, right now children and young people have less opportunities than they previously had. And if actually we can't carry on the current trajectory, they're going to have even fewer opportunities. And that's, I just wanted to specifically press the rest of the panel on the impact on children and young people, on potentially, you know, charging for museums was mentioned earlier, and various other things. I know Cara was talking about the impact on disabled children and young people. I think it's, if we're talking about outcomes, I'm particularly interested to hear what people think about the current budget trajectory we'll have on life opportunities for children and young people.
And Dan, did you want to
come in? I'll come in on that. Thank you very much for that question. I think I've touched on it a little bit already. But I do think there will be a limiting of opportunities to children and young people if more museums move towards this kind of funding model of generating income through entry fees. It's a real barrier. We're going to see less family visits, less school visits, and that is a real concern. But on top of that, I think there is a concern that I've mentioned already, that when cuts are made, it tends to be learning engagement staff that go first. It tends to be a reduction in learning engagement activities that are kind of cost-saving measures made first. And that has a direct impact on children and young people. A lot of the time, museums offer a plethora of really exciting and engaging activities for children and young people to engage them in the museum, because we know that we have to build those relationships and we have to do a bit extra to engage audiences. We can't just expect them to come into the space and find it engaging. We have to work with our communities and identify who isn't coming and work to attract people to those spaces, and that includes young people and children, to make sure that the museum's is an engaging space to them. So I think there is a real risk with continued cuts that it will have a direct impact there.
Okay. Does anyone else want to come? Liam, thanks.
Yeah, just absolutely building on that point, thanks for the question. I think lots of our members work in provision of participation for children and young people right across the country in terms of geography, but also in terms of actively looking to reach across social divides. A lot of that work's done on a zero cost or a very limited cost basis. All of that's under threat in terms of the cost pressure to maintaining that, and that obviously raises quite profound questions around equality of opportunity and access. We've got members that deliver performance opportunities at world-class level. In Edinburgh, we've got Imaginate delivering the Edinburgh International Children's Festival. It's kind of one of the festivals that's held up around the world as an exemplar of how to do that and do it well in terms of partnership working. And that the commitment of that is about giving people and children and young people in this instance the opportunity to sort of transform their worldview and their confidence and how they feel about the world, regardless of what they go on to do next. Some people do actively go on and choose a career in the culture sector, but actually that's not the intention. Is about giving people better life chances and children and young people, and there's a huge commitment to that, but as we've already touched on, it's under enormous strain. And the risk there is that in order to provide the service on an ongoing basis, you get a kind of creep in of a charging agenda, through not through choice, but through just sheer necessity. And that's what nobody wants, because the fundamental principle that people are trying to deliver in is a kind of equality of opportunity, and that everyone deserves the opportunity to participate in these activities.
Okay, David.
Just to build on that point about cultural careers, I think this is one of the other areas to which we have a concern about where we are with funding within the sector. The sector, the museum sector, the gallery sector, acknowledges that diversity is already a huge problem within their workforce. And one of the concerns we have about this insecurity of funding is we are struggling to see what career paths into the sector now look like without having to go through a series of temporary, fixed-term, insecure jobs, or in some cases unpaid jobs entirely, volunteering. Because to get into it, you'll have had to get into a permanent role, you'll have had to have done that work to be able to get in. And we don't see how what a career path now looks like to get into the sector unless you have some means of support beyond the salary you'd get paid to do the work. You know, the challenge we get put back to us from some of our members is, I can afford to work here because my partner works for a bank. But that doesn't help with the next generation coming in. And, you know, I can understand why people from the outside looking at a career in culture will be asking themselves questions about, can I afford to do this? Is this something that I can afford my children to do?
Thank you. Cara?
Yeah, I think just your point, Neil, is really valid. The children, young people that we work with are, I suppose, the most hidden in society and face the largest barriers in terms of accessing what's already there in terms of supports. And there are huge supports there. I mean, the myriad of different initiatives that Scottish Government have taken in terms of the Looked After Children Attainment Fund, really creative ways that we can support young people. I guess there's a lot of fragmentation and sometimes not a lot of coherency in terms of how local authorities can administer those funds or allow us to innovate services to be able to, you know, access those funds differently. And I think we probably need a clear framework for that cross-departmental cultural investment on a national level, but also on a local authority level. And I guess what the strategy refresh is trying to do is to look at the role of culture across all of those sectors, but to empower local authorities to take the risk to buy in different ways of commissioning services to look at what can be enhancing educational cultural access for those children. And just to give you an example, we've got you were talking about the ring fencing. That would be amazing. That would be an absolute springboard. You know, even if you took 1% SNP commitment, just on the level four funding would release 18.5 million ring fence funding for arts to be able to levy in different types of resources. We try and raise a pound for every pound of public expenditure we're given in a local authority. We try and raise another pound on top of that. That's pretty good value.
Okay, thanks. Duncan, did you want to come in?
Just to say, I mean, I think it's a very good question. The cultural sector has been very effective at diversifying its audiences and attracting young people and to move to their audiences reflecting the communities in which they operate. But the kind of activities which support that are those which are most vulnerable, given the kind of financial pressure we're experiencing. And that desperation to keep the doors open is the last final sign of collapse. Those kind of things go by the wayside. And what we do is build in a problem for audiences down the line because we're not attracting the current generation of young people. We're not becoming part of their everyday life. So it's the very area which is most vulnerable, given the current financial situation.
Thank you. Could I bring in Mr. Brown, please?
Thanks so much. Thanks for the contribution so far. I should just say that I spent 2.5 hours in Edinburgh Central Library yesterday, which means I'll spend more time in the library than at a Scottish Premiership game this week. It's pretty unusual for me. I think for me, and I'm a new member to the committee, I think context is quite important here, and some of the points that India made about the fact that you've seen, you know, in local government, and as far as we're talking about local government here, and of course it's not just local government, 8 councils going bankrupt south of the border, a 40% reduction in funding to local government, and the idea that Scotland can be immune from that is just a nonsense debate as far as I'm concerned. And also you mentioned about the example in Wales of assets being sold off. And also just to say that much of what's been said just now, I have to say, has been said for at least 35 years. When I first joined local government in 1988, the same discussions were taking place. Words like cliff edge and crisis. Now, I think we have had continued, as Duncan said, managed decline. In fact, it goes back to the mid-70s when the government had to go to the IMF to get funding. But you've had managed decline of public services over that time, and 13 years of austerity doesn't help that. So what's really useful to me is to understand the context. So, for example, in your paper, Duncan, you mentioned two figures, 36% decline in public library services between 2010-11 and 2021, and also 22% another figure in relation to museums. It would be useful to me to know how that compares with the rest of the UK, because we're not talking about a different... The comparison is valid because the same funding is underlying much of it. And also to know, and the reason for that is I'd quite like to know where it is the Scottish Government is doing either something good, don't maybe expect to get too much of that, but where it's doing something which is neglectful or impinging on the cultural sector, which it could change. I mean, Liam's made a couple of suggestions in terms of potential ring fencing and other things as well, but that, getting a context and a feel for where, which is, I think, a big part of this committee's role, where the Scottish Government could improve, or where it's doing well and should do more of it, that is probably more relevant or more useful to me in trying to get a handle on some of these things.
I think that a very, very good question. And the paper does quote some figures in terms of the cuts. In relation to the rest of the UK, certainly for museums, it would appear that local authority cuts have been a bit more severe. That's slightly misleading. If you look purely at local authority direct funding to museums in Scotland, the cuts have been less drastic. The figure it doesn't recognise is there's some direct central government funding to local authority museums, or most local authority museums in England, which compensates for the difference. So the overall level of public funding has declined by about the same amount. You're right that you know, I've been in the public sector for a long time. We've been cutting pretty much for the entirety of my career. Miraculously, we're still here. But I think that the problem we have now is twofold. The cuts have been going on for a very long time, and actually the level of funding doesn't match the level of public aspiration, and public aspiration is probably going up. But I think critically, the problem where the Scottish Government may be able to assist is that currently we're in a furious process of continuing to minimise that decline. But actually, if we could rethink the sector, it may be that with a little bit more funding, we could still deliver a great deal. But actually, at the moment, we're having multiple conversations across the country all about shrinking what we're doing. And that makes it difficult to look at cooperation. It makes it difficult to look at shared services. And there's not really a conversation identifying what it is that as a society we wish to see delivered for our population, and we wish to see delivered to maintain our economic prosperity and to encourage inward investment. And that's being lost in the white noise of managing the endless rounds of cuts. And I think that's the difficulty. And if you look back over time, I was reading some memos from Julian Spalding, a predecessor of mine in the late 90s, bemoaning the budget cuts they were experiencing at the time, and some of the sentences I had written myself. But we had a period of stability which followed that and regrouped and created a service that was different but actually could cope with its contemporary environment through the noughties and up to the last 10 years. At the moment, we don't have that breathing space and an opportunity to reimagine and to restructure and to amend our services. And I think that's the difficulty. It's a rapid process of decline which is soaking up all of the capacity. And if we could stabilise that, it would make a huge difference to how we could actually meet the government's agenda.
Does anyone else? I've got you down, Mark. Coming in next, but I'll go to India and then to Liam.
Thank you. Yes. So, just to do a sort of comparison again between Scotland and the rest of the UK. So I mentioned the figure earlier about a decrease in investment of 23% in the decade between the financial years 2009-10 and 2019-20. Obviously, it might be, it's very likely going to be even more than that now within the last 2 years and the impact of the cost of living. But when we did that research, we did also have there was a similar picture in the rest of the UK in terms of a kind of reduction in investment in the decade of austerity. However, when we look at England, we can see that there's two key sources of funding for the museum sector that isn't available in Scotland. So one of these is the Arts Council England through the National Portfolio Organisations. Between 2023 and 2026, 77 museums across England will receive £36.5 million. And that is to go towards core funding, which I've already mentioned is just so essential for the museum sector. And of course, that figure would need to be proportional to the population of and sector in Scotland, but that's still a significant investment that would make a massive difference to the landscape in Scotland if there was a source of core funding that museums could access. And once that the core funding into the infrastructure that museums provide, into the buildings, into the staff, and into the collections, that's what then will generate all of the other outcomes that we've been talking about health and well-being, about engaging new audiences, delivering for young people and children. Like, this is what needs to be invested in before all of those other outcomes can be realised. The other source of funding is the Museum Estate and Development Fund, which is a capital fund, and it goes towards urgent maintenance and infrastructure. We've already mentioned about the real issues with buildings that museum collections are housed in. A lot of them are very old and have a lot of issues that come along with that. So it would be really welcome for a similar fund like this in Scotland to really address these really urgent issues needed to the maintenance and infrastructure of buildings. You also asked about something that Scotland's doing well. And I would say the ambition set out in the museum strategy is fantastic. We're really pleased to see Scotland really recognising the role that museums can have in anti-racism, in decolonisation, and the role of museums within all of that. And this is something that's absent in England, so it's really great to see that here, that there is this ambition, but along with this ambition, we do need the funding to accompany it to fully realise this. And these ambitions will not be realised without that core funding.
Liam, did you want to come in, and then I'll bring David and Pamela as well.
Great, thanks. Yeah, I mean, absolutely, point well made. I think we're not immune to the kind of global economic dynamics to all of this. I'm going to pick up the ambition theme in the first instance that India's introduced. When I talk to theatre and dance colleagues south of the border, consistently over many, many years, one of the things they've said is, you've got a government that gets this. And I don't think that's what they always say about the UK government in sort of universal terms. So I think it's about how we turn that ambition into reality. One of the things, though, that we look slightly more enviously south on is the stability of multi-year funding. I think if the Scottish Government could enable Creative Scotland to go through its multi-year funding process over the next 12 months and to award genuine multi-year commitments, that could be transformative in terms of the stability that it would provide and then be a platform on which to build that ambition. Just one other thing in terms of a UK-wide context. Members are probably aware that the UK Treasury and HMRC are consulting just now on the cultural tax reliefs legislation. There's some quite worrying amendments being discussed, certainly as it relates to theatre tax relief. Two of them are particularly worrying to our members. One is that the guidance around what qualifies as a exempt or a tax relief eligible piece of performance would change. So it would remove from scope some of the more immersive theatrical experiences. Now, that's something that the sector in Scotland are really excellent at. And back to the children and young people point, a lot of these experiences are actually designed to be immersive, to be involve the participants as audience members rather than to be more stand back and take it in. That would have a huge implication in terms of the overall stability of the sector of that relief. And the other one is that they are consulting that they would potentially not pay out any tax relief if the tax relief is material to the solvency of the claiming applicant. So you can see that, back to the perfect storm analogy, if because theatre tax relief, particularly at the current levels that Treasury have said they'll uphold to 2025, and there's a massive amount of lobbying to extend that forever, if you get into a kind of a vicious circle scenario where actually the theatre tax relief is the underpinning element because of all the other cost pressures and income pressures, you could have a real exacerbated collapse if that guidance goes through. So anything, again, that the Scottish Government can do to bear lobbying pressure onto UK Government as it goes through this exercise on tax reliefs would be hugely important.
Is it a supplementary? Yeah. Very quickly.
Yeah, so multi-year fundings came up and stability fundings came up quite a few times. The Cabinet Secretary in the letter to us has talked about, you know, he's keen to work on it, but he says future years could be best only indicative in terms of budgets. Is that not kind of a bit pointless? Like, is it not impossible to plan future years on figures that are just, like, at best indicative?
I think yes. In short, yes. And again, with the overall level of budget that the culture budget represents, I'm not sure there are many in the sector that understand why we can't get to this sooner. And I'm slightly hesitant to say what I'm about to say next, but in a way of kind of finding some central ground, even indicating on a multi-year basis a minimum amount of money that would be awarded, no matter what scenarios the government might face, would bring stability. This constant caveat of every year the entire sector has to wait and go through a budgeting exercise is fundamentally destabilising the sector in the way that we've discussed already.
David, and then Palmer, thanks.
So the National Library is actually, you know, almost a metaphor for kind of the points we're making, that the bit which is visible to the public is in fact the 11th floor, and there's 10 floors of stacks beneath it, which is storage for their collection. one of several sites of storage for the collection which the public don't see, all of which are things, the foundation that that experience is built upon. In terms of what Scotland does well and maybe isn't in the rest of the UK, I'm going to play a little bit to type and talk about pay. That our research this year, and it's been backed up by similar research done by ICON, the curators organisation, shows that staff in Scotland are now better paid than staff in London, unbelievably so. That the cost, the salaries now have gone ahead of the London salaries. I genuinely have no idea how our London membership afford to live in London and work for some of those collections. Some of that has been because of work done by Scottish Government to insist on minimum standards around living wage, and that we've managed to replicate some of that out of charities. We would like to see more of that, and that being pushed out to other bodies funded through Creative Scotland and others to raise those standards in some of the smaller charitable organisations. But it has to come with funding. It has to be carrot rather than stick. Saying to them, you must pay the living wage to qualify for funding, it may well, in some cases, force them to close. We want the funding to be there to make sure they can pay a salary at the level which people can actually afford to survive and live and have those standards.
Okay. Pamela?
I would just like to say that it's fascinating to compare, I suppose, Scotland with the rest of the UK, but as far as libraries go, I think colleagues elsewhere in the UK would say that libraries in Scotland have a much more coordinated approach to their service delivery. And to a certain extent, colleagues down south envy the opportunity that we have to develop services in Scotland. And that's partly because we have a national strategy for public libraries in Scotland, which is supported by both the Scottish Government and COSLA. And that's enabled us not just to attract project funding from the government for different work packages, but also from the private sector. So we've actually been able to leverage funding outside the public sector to support public libraries. However, I suppose if I was going to benchmark libraries, I probably wouldn't benchmark the rest of the UK. I would probably be looking to the Republic of Ireland, I'd be looking to Scandinavia, I'd be looking to Australia. And all those models of funding include direct funding from the government to the library sector. So some of them, it's a mixture of local government running libraries, but there's actually direct funding to help deliver programmes. So I think that might be something that would help, I suppose, support the sector through these challenging times, but also, I suppose, supporting government priorities, supporting the National Performance Framework and so on. So I don't look to England and the delivery model there as something we would want to emulate, and I would be quite sorry if we actually ended up moving in that direction, because I think we've got something worth protecting.
Keith?
Yeah, it wasn't so much about a comparison, although it's really interesting to hear that between the different services, and it wasn't so much about, Liam said, a global economic situation. It's simply the fact that in Scotland, the budget is driven by what the government in Westminster wants to spend on its services, and we get what we get as a consequence of that. It's not thought about what do we need, it's what we should get as a consequence. And there's a vital difference between ourselves, Ireland and Australia, which is pretty obvious. I'm just going to raise a question. I'm not looking for an answer because I know you're pressed for time, but I was really interested in the Van Gogh exhibition, which happened last year in Edinburgh. I think it's going to other places now. And I know one of the issues is the cost. For a lot of people, you won't be able to pay to get it. But I just wonder if there's anything in that kind of initiative which might be helpful to museums, given the treasures that they have, that kind of bespoke kind of exhibition travelling around. Anyway, I'm not looking for an answer just now because I know you've got to move on.
We shall move on. Thank you for that. Mr. Ruskell.
Yeah, thanks very much, and thanks for your evidence this morning. It's been really useful, I think, to get an updated picture for this year. I had a couple of questions. I wanted to go back to Liam's point around, you know, what a strategic, transformative approach to embedding culture would look like. And I think, you know, I saw a lot of colleagues sort of nodding their heads around the table when you were talking, and then, you know, others have come in and kind of explained what that might actually look like in terms of services, particularly struck by some of the work that ArtLink are doing on the ground, links to education, mental health, everything else. But I suppose the question is kind of, can you point to an area within the UK where councils, devolved administrations, other bodies have actually taken that leap and said, yes, we're going to do this. We're going to do the full Christie. We're going to, you know, tackle preventative spend. We're going to really invest in culture for all the transformation that we know that it can achieve. Because, you know, if there is an example we could point at, that would be useful. And then my second question, if you want, is just to kind of wrap this in right now. It's just around other sources of funding. So, you know, we've had more evidence coming in from the Music Venues Trust about not just cultural tax relief, which, you know, we've already mentioned, but, you know, relief for small venues, potential for levy on stadium and arena shows. And I'm kind of struck by the fact that, you know, clearly culture makes a lot of money and a lot of wealth, but there's big culture, and then I would make a distinction between big culture and what, you know, the cultural organisations and practices that you're involved with. So it's how we can see a kind of transfer of wealth from big culture to community culture. And then I suppose linked to that, you know, if you've got any thoughts on transient visitor levy, other sources of income that could come into the sector during these difficult times. I'm kind of struck by, you know, that figure of 1%, 18.5 million. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that could come from government. It could come from a variety of other sources as well. So, yeah, interest in those two points.
Dame, do you want to jump in and respond? Or? Yeah, India?
Thank you. Yes, yeah, so in terms of a strategic vision, I do think that the Museum Strategy for Scotland and the Culture Strategy does provide clear ambitions for the culture and museum sectors. And of course, we're waiting in anticipation for the refreshed action plan to come along with the culture strategy. But I'm just reiterating the same point I've made already, that any kind of actions or ambitions do really need to have funding attached to them for them to be meaningful and for these ambitions to be realised. In terms of ways that we could generate more funding, I would really welcome that idea of the 1% of budgets kind of being ring-fence for culture. I think we've also heard a lot of talk about the percentage for the arts and the money that could generate, but I would really encourage the scope of that to be broadened to percentage for culture so that all cultural organisations can benefit from that. I think that would be really transformative. And the visitor levy bill, I think that there is real potential for that to bring income. We know that museums contribute greatly and the wider culture sector contributes greatly to the visitor economy. But we need museums to be in the room during these discussions. We need them to be able to contribute to how the progress of this bill is going. And as well, if it is fully realised, we need them to be in the room when the decisions are being made of where this money should go to make sure that it is being reinvested back into the museums and the cultural organisations that are really making Scotland an attractive place to visit and a vibrant place to visit.
Liam, you wanted to come in?
Yep. I mean, I think there's a thing. I've got one contextual example that I'll pick up in a moment, but I think it's, for me, it's about starting with the context we already understand here but need to understand better. I think there's something about the sum total of the parts that exist within our cultural ecology that if we could create mechanisms and ways of bringing that sum total together, that in itself would be transformative. And back to Keith, your question around, I mean, one of the things I think is really exciting about being a citizen in Scotland is that we have a government that's committed to the wellbeing economy. That is truly transformative, and that's not a UK-wide thing. So for me, it's about what's the cultural contribution to a massive transformation agenda around as we move towards net zero that is going to place wellbeing and economic prosperity at the heart of that. Bring that kind of sum total up. I do think what's going on in Manchester is interesting in terms of how they understand that kind of network. They've looked north of the border on a whole host of things, whether it's international festivals, kind of venue development, and they're absolutely got their act together and kind of really thinking about what that kind of northwest cultural regeneration agenda looks like, not only in terms of big culture, to use your term, but also that kind of wider impacts piece. And I think you make a really important point about the kind of different components in a cultural ecology that are really important. You don't get the kind of headline acts in a music or performing arts context, or probably any context, if they've not had the opportunity to hone their craft. So there is something about how we generate ways of taking levy, ways of taking some of that kind of economic impact that people are benefiting on in the kind of big culture arena, and really reinvest it into that grassroots agenda, which includes participation, because then you get the health and wellbeing outcomes, but you also get that kind of stability of talent pipeline that is absolutely vital in all of that.
Yeah, Cara? Of local initiatives that are worthwhile mentioning here in terms of creative commissioning models. So the Thrive Edinburgh is a network of emotional mental wellbeing network who have looked at what they can do collectively through the arts and others to protect the mental health of their communities. And the Edinburgh Community Commissioning through EVOC, that's through the Community Mental Health Framework Funding.
Thank you. David and then Duncan.
I think that point around big culture is really interesting. When I've been talking about organisations' budget challenges, I've been particularly talking about the National Museum, the National Library and the National Galleries. I haven't particularly been talking about Historic Environment Scotland. It's not that they are not without budget challenges, they absolutely are, but they have the Edinburgh Castle and Stirling Castle. It is an oversimplification to say that they pay for everything else, but it's not so far away from the truth. And that is big culture paying for little culture. But it is a quirk of history that those are part of Historic Environment Scotland, rather than any strategic plan, rather than sitting with local government or with a charity or some other. And if there are more opportunities to link up that big culture into little culture and get that grassroots that funding from the big high-profile attractions into smaller areas, as happens in Historic Environment Scotland, I think that would be really interesting to see. But a lot of our structures don't allow that to happen just now.
Just to pick up on the point Liam raised, we do have a cultural ecosystem in Scotland which is actually currently very effective at developing talent, both front of house and back of house talent, and it's why Scotland in many respects punches above its weight culturally, and we have some amazing world class content coming out of the country. But it's a delicate system, and actually one of the problems with this, the current situation where independent decisions are being taken, is that it jeopardises that, because you can take one element away which seems in itself relatively modest, but the impact actually on the ecosystem can be quite dramatic. And so that's one of the concerns I have, that some kind of overview to have a sense that we're not inadvertently losing something which is really important is something which we don't currently have.
Okay. Mark, did you...
That was all good.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring Alexander in, and then I'll come to.
thank you, convener. I mean, thank you. This has really been an excellent session, because you really have been very candid about where you are and each of your organisations and how you feel. And you know, long-term finances from local government have been discussed, and local government is still probably the one who's the most significant funder in many aspects of culture sector throughout Scotland. But it's you know, you've talked about the managing decline and fighting for survival. And in all my time, I had the opportunity to spend 18 years in local government from 1997, and during that time I said similar when I was in that sector and trying to manage where we are. And since I've come here, since 2016, the Scottish Government have come forward with action plans, they've come forward with strategies, they've come forward with working groups. And you've all participated, I'm sure, in amongst all of those. And it would be interesting to hear from you if you do feel that you are listened to within these action plans, within these working groups and strategies. And what is the future? From today's meeting, it sounds quite bleak in reality. But is there a sector, or is there a way forward? that you see within your own organisation that you can and you want to achieve. You've talked about other parts of the globe and things that are done differently. We have said here that we punch above our weight, that I think Ian said, you know, that Scotland gets it when it comes to culture and does understand, but there's obviously still a massive gap that we still need to fill. And it's how we manage to fill that gap and how we manage to really be the world leading, because we are. There's no question that we are world leading in many sectors, and we have the pride of that. And our culture is very strong in our identity in Scotland. But we need to see the future. So what is the future? And do you believe that you are actually listened to and given that opportunity amongst all those strategies, those plans and these working groups?
Liam?
Great question. Thank you for that. I would say the answer is yes, but with a caveat. And the caveat is there will have to be some material change being seen in what comes through in the budget bill. And I think that's twofold. I think that is one around a commitment to what stability of central cultural funding looks like. But to pick up your point, what that also translates beyond that into local government funding, so that the local government does not retract any further than it already has done. And then I think the third strand to that is, because this last bit's probably the most complex, if we want to move to a cross-portfolio approach of cultural contribution, that's probably not achieved in one budget round, but we need an active pathway to that over the rest of this parliamentary term.
Anyone else want to come in? Pamela?
Well, I echo exactly what Liam said, but also just to say, yes, I do think we are listened to in the working groups that we participate in. But also to say that I think the situation that we've got, and I kind of kicked off with this, it's not something that's happened over the last 12 months or so. It has been going on for a considerable period of time. And you can't keep reducing what is now minuscule budgets without the model having to change. And that means a reduction in the service. And that is where we are. That is the reality. And while I too have worked in the public sector for long, many years and experienced various budget rounds, I think we are in a different scenario at the moment. But yes, I think some of the points that Liam made are perhaps ways to mitigate that.
Anyone else? I'm not seeing any other people jumping at that one. Alexander, have you got any other questions?
The other thing is that, you know, there's been talk in the past about the central belt in Scotland seems to receive the biggest lion's share of things. Do you think that's the case? I know there are fantastic organisations at the length and breadth of the country, but is the lion's share of the resource and the manpower and the artistic involvement or cultural involvement, is it central belt based? Do you think that?
It's a good question. I believe it just reflects the really unbalanced spread of our population. We have an odd demographic mix and that distorts the way in which culture is delivered, and I think that's often a difficulty for us in comparing ourselves with models south of the border, where actually what we're trying to do is wildly different, so I think that's inevitable. I think in terms of local authority funding, I don't think it's particularly skewed towards the central belt. It just reflects the investment of those authorities. You will get that impact of national institutions if they're in the major cities, inevitably create that, the same as London has in England. It's the same factor. But I think the risk in where we are now is that the smaller scale provision, not in the central belt, is existentially vulnerable. And I think that so you can end up with an even more skewed pattern of provision than we currently have, which I think comes back to that idea that we really need to have a sense of what is the minimum provision we aspire to nationally and what actually the building blocks we have to deliver effective cultural provision across the whole of the country. And I don't think we have a sense of that. There's nowhere where that's been put together.
David?
I think at least some of it is what I was referring to as the quirks of history, whereby organisations and properties which are run by central government bodies like Historic Environment Scotland or the National Museum happen to be in the central belt or on the East Coast, whereas those which are in the Highlands and Islands, and again, I'm making generalisations because it is not overly, have tended to fall more to organisations like National Trust of Scotland and other smaller charities. And they are the ones for whom they are facing challenges around fundraising, around tourism, around particular issues. I mean, we have had members reporting to us the particular issues around Oban and Ben Laws about retracting staff, not necessarily because of salaries, simply because there is no accommodation. You know, that they, that you cannot get visitor services or catering staff or anything because they can't afford to live in their area because there is no accommodation for them to get. It's a wider issue around accommodation with that area of the country. But it is not necessarily funded directly out the cultural budget, rather through Creative Scotland and then out into those charities. So it's several steps removed.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, I appreciate we're here to, you know, discuss the Scottish Government's budget, but I just wanted to ask about the role of the private sector. And it has been touched on a few times already this morning. But do witnesses of the panel, people here, feel that there is more potential here to help with funding in relation to the private sector? I mean, there have been some, I think David mentioned, well-documented issues over the summer in relation to the book festival here in Edinburgh. But I'm not really talking about sponsorship. I'm more interested in kind of imaginative ways involving the private sector or indeed the charitable sector in helping with this dilemma, and whether anyone felt that that was viable and ways in which that could happen. I don't know if anyone's got any reflections on that. Yeah.
I think the short answer is yes, and I'm glad you said, you know, beyond sponsorship, because I think that's absolutely, we've got to move the kind of focus collectively beyond that, and not least because the discretionary spend budgets that sponsorship arrangements have traditionally come from are under a challenge for the private sector as well. I think there's some interesting ventures that have been set up in the last year or so. I'm thinking of Culture and Businesses Marketplace Venture, which is looking at the kind of reciprocal skills exchange that can happen between those in the culture sector and those in the private sector around, you know, presentation training, for example. And so in our sector, there are a number of our members who actively sell or exchange on a kind of common exchange basis presentation skills. So do you have staff that need to deliver presentations, hold meetings? Can we help? And then vice versa, what can the private sector help with? I think that needs expedited in terms of that. I think it also fits really well within the frame of the wellbeing economy, which is looking at other kind of economic transaction models rather than just it all being about selling necessarily. How can you exchange skills? I think it would also be interesting to see how that sort of model scaled up would fit within a CROTS portfolio agenda, because then you've got a kind of examination of the skills within a wider economy and looking at who's got what particular strengths in what areas. So I think there's some interesting work on the ground. Is it transformative yet? Nowhere near it. And at the same time, we're seeing the sponsorship agendas come down. So we've got to really think about that pathway across the next few years that brings together, because every bit of the economy is under strain at the moment, and I think we all accept that, certainly in the theatre and dance sector, we understand the private sector as well. So it's about how we can pull together with common cause.
I think, you know, going back to what said earlier on about collaborative working and common goals, I think it's about finding that territory with the private sector. And recently, libraries had a bit of success working with the John Lewis Partnership, where they had a circular future initiative on the go, and they were looking to support work, or if you like, you know, reach out to the community to promote that whole circular future discussion. And through discussion with ourselves and application from SLIC, they have sponsored a number of lend and mend hubs across libraries in Scotland, which has not only involved libraries, but actually seen them engage with the third sector and community groups to actually deliver a new service through libraries in Scotland. So I think it does exist. I've seen other examples of libraries working, not just in Scotland, but beyond Scotland as well, with journalists and the newspaper industry, again around common goals, around freedom of expression, around curating collections and maintaining collections. So I think, you know, it's maybe not every industry that's open to the culture sector, but I'm sure that there are many examples where common purposes exist.
Duncan?
Just very quickly, I think it's a very good point, and I would say what I've seen in the last 10 years is a sector that's become much more imaginative in engaging with the private sector and much more hard-headed about how much it charges to do that. So I think it is a significant income stream. The challenge, as Liam alluded earlier, is that the scale of that doesn't equal the budget pressures we are facing from public sector funding, and it's how you sustain organisations. But one of the aspirations absolutely has to be continue to maximise that source of income, and I think there is real potential there.
You're fine, Donald. I think that's, unless I can't see any hands going up desperately, I think that's exhausted us all today. Oh, Keith, yeah, certainly.
Answer, but if anybody's got any thoughts on it, if you could maybe write back to us. But on Donald's point, I think the point I was raising about the Van Gogh exhibition, I don't know enough about it, other than the fact that it's probably the only art exhibition I've been to, but it seems to me that probably raised an awful lot of money, and I don't know who it raised money for, and if there's anything that can be learned about that, because they probably used pieces of art which were in public collections. So just to see whether any thought can be given, because I think they made a huge amount of money just in Edinburgh, but then it's gone into, I think, London and Manchester. And on the other hand, just to say, I mentioned I was in Edinburgh City Library yesterday, the Central Library. It's got an exhibition there on witches. It sits just right next to where most witches were killed in Edinburgh, and yet there was virtually nobody in that building at all. The streets were packed still, even post-festival, with tourists from everywhere, and I think a little bit of advertising, you could have had folk going in there. I mean, even the library part of it was virtually empty, but you could have folk going in there who may also go into the library, and you could possibly monetise it as well. That may be anathema to some people, but any kind of entrepreneurial ideas that might help with the funding situation, I think, would be worth hearing about, and I think for the work of the committee. Certainly for me, if anyone's got any ideas, if they want to send them in.
Thank you. I think we'll leave it there. Thank you. It's been a long session, but very, very helpful. And again, thank you all for your submission work, for coming along today. And no doubt you'll see the outcomes in the coming weeks when we make our recommendations on the budget. So thank you very much. I'm going to now go into private session and we'll have a brief 5-minute suspension for...